Welcome back to the second part of Left, Right and Center. What impact is COVID-19 going to have on 2020? Small investors have been hit hard. There has been an interest rate in saving schemes which has been slashed. Public Provident Fund, which was earlier at 7.9, is now at 7.1. This is today's news, by the way. National Savings Certificate earlier was at 7.9, now at 6.8. Sukanya Samriddhi scheme earlier was at 8.4 and now at 7.6%. But this is only one part of the story. We are staring at a situation where there could be possibly job losses in an already difficult situation of unemployment. At a time when we had a prevailing situation of a slowdown, what impact is COVID-19 going to have on 2020 in terms of economy? Let's take a look at this presentation.
On the first day of the new financial year, the stock markets closed 4% lower amid continuing coronavirus fears. The Sensex dropped over 1,200 points to end at 28,265, while Nifty slipped 300 points. Intense selling pressures in banking, financial services and IT sectors led the slide. With the number of coronavirus cases rising in the world and with the US government estimating over 1 lakh deaths, investors and fund managers are struggling to formalize a strategy going forward.
As long as we is around, it is very difficult for the economic activities to go back on the track, and the sooner we win the war against COVID-19, better for mankind and the economy also.
Infosys, HDFC Bank, TCS, Reliance Industries were the biggest losers on markets. Maruti Suzuki announced its monthly sales figures, which showed the steepest drop ever of 48% year-on-year for the month of March because of the lockdown's effect on the economy. Maruti Suzuki closed on Sensex 1.5% lower. Small investors in saving schemes have also been hit hard, with the government slashing interest rates for the first quarter. For public provident funds, earlier rate of interest was 7.9%, which is now at 7.1%. For National Savings Certificate, earlier rate was 7.9%, now at 6.8%. Sukanya Samriddhi Account Scheme, earlier the rate was 8.4% and now it is 7.6%.
These returns look like a very nominal return, rate decline. Interest rates coming down by anywhere between 80 basis point to 1% on small savings, various instrument. It varies for different things. But effectively translates into 11 to 13% decline in income.
The new financial year has started with uncertain and volatile times, at least in the short run. Everyone currently is in the wait and watch mode as to how the COVID situation will evolve from here on. In Mumbai, this is Purva Chitnis for NDTV.
Okay, joining us right now from Nellore is Mr. Mekkapati Gautam Reddy. He's the Minister for Industries, Commerce and Information Technology of the Government of Andhra Pradesh. Thank you very much, Mr. Reddy. Its impact on economy, its impact, say, for instance, on your state. I want to understand what is your assessment, what is your calculation, what is your reading? How badly is it going to hit financially, economy, in terms of economy?
Good evening, Sanket. To answer your question before this, I would just like to bring out one valid point. The government, historically we have had post-bifurcation, the government state budget, the government of Andhra Pradesh state budget, but we had, which always had been a lot of deficit, and there's a lot of this, the bifurcation act that was yet to be, concurred with. But however, to start with, with this onset of this virus and what has happened, its role that it's playing right now in the industry in Andhra Pradesh is that, especially the MSME sectors that we see, which is already under tremendous pressure in the historically past, because of, the downslide that we've had. With this onset of this virus and, with the production cycles coming down, from 100% down there, most of the industries are running at one third of their capacities. I'm more worried about this MSMEs sector, which is going to take one of the biggest hits. And also, if you have to understand, especially our farm-based agro industries, which is another industry also, which is also going to be taking another big hit. If you really look at, if you look at what is our, whether our sugar industries or whether you look at our food processing industries, you know, these are all some of the industries which are going to be taking a big hit in this coming days. One of the things that we have actually done at, you know, at our end is that making sure that most of the industries in terms of, you know, in this time that we've asked all of them to actually continue their productions, and we give them all kinds of security for their employees and the labor in terms of providing, making sure that, you know, we give them essential commodities and making sure that, you know, the quarantine zones are are put in place. So in that way, the industry in our end has been playing, the department has been playing very actively in engaging the industry and making sure that whatever advices that we're getting from them, and we're making it, you know, we're adhering to that.
Now, post-corona, at a time when Indian economy will be in a recovery mode, whether it's a U-shaped recovery or a V-shaped recovery or a slow recovery, do you think that states would then need some sort of a financial assistance from the center?
Actually, let me say that, you know, what advantages can we come out of this, you know, after this post-crisis? You know, if you really see, in the post-crisis, we will see that, you know, much of the manufacturing is going to be moving out of China. And it is a known fact, you know, what has ever happened. And you see, there's a lot of the Western countries, companies which have invested in China are slowly looking out either to Southeast Asia or to South Asia. So actually, if we can be proactive, I think the government of India has been a little proactive in this recently, the policies that they've brought out. And if we can make sure that, you know, we are well equipped, especially when I say this is that, again, I'll come back and reiterate that, you know, this MSME sector, which has had, which has been under pressure, if we can give them some sort of a moratorium on their loans and also make sure that they have access to capital, I can see that, you know, the recovery for India is going to be much quicker than any other country. And also, if you understand the, if you look at the social and the economic displacement that has happened in this country vis-a-vis with any other country, I think we have contained it and we are a lot more positive than many other countries that are there. And if you just give you a point in example right now, we have in Andhra Pradesh, we have Andhra Pradesh Medical Tech Zone. So we have actually, through Government of India, it's a joint venture between we have actually asked this MedTech Zone to start manufacturing ventilators. And from April 15th, MedTech Zone is going to be starting to manufacture almost close to about 3,000 ventilators, which is very much requirement right now today in a lot of our states in India. And also, we are going to be manufacturing something like 25,000 the corona test kits, the diagnostic kits that is going to be very crucial for us. So in terms of, we've also seen that, you know, there's a lot of medical equipment that can, you know, sort of like requirements are there, where these such initiatives are being taken up and then making sure that we are able to address the present day's requirements.
All right, Mr. Reddy, many thanks for joining us right here on NDTV. Let me now go to Supriya Sinesh. She's a spokesperson of the Congress Party, a former journalist. Supriya, good to have you on the show. Nasir Saleem, managing partner of Flexi Capital. Professor Arun Kumar is an economist, and Rajat Sethi, advisor to the Manipur chief minister and also a political analyst, are going to join us in just a short moment. Supriya, post-corona, how do you assess the economic impact? Or do you think that we are still in the process of gauging what the real economic impact is going to be? Too hard to tell right now.
No, Sanket, and I wish that all of you at NDTV and everybody else watching this program is safe and sound. I don't think we are in the process of gauging. I think there is going to be significant economic pain that our economy is going to go through. Already there are signs of the economic activity coming to a complete grinding halt. Please understand what's happening. This is unprecedented. Work has come to a complete halt across sectors, across industries. It's not just the large enterprises, but the small enterprises as well. Remember, in a population of 130 crore people, there are 47 crore people who actually work, and 81% of them work in the unorganized sector. They have been the hardest hit by this lockdown and by the coronavirus. And these are the people who are the most vulnerable. They do not have the kind of social security that organized sector offers. And because that is the backbone of the Indian economy, it's going to be completely broken, which is why we've been saying repeatedly, and we don't want to sound partisan. I think One has to solidly stand with the government with every effort that is being made to arrest this this sort of a crisis. Every effort has to be directed in the direction where we can also arrest the economic slowdown, which is going to be the obvious impact out of this. And I think on that front, the situation is absolutely dreadful. If I'm not going to sound alarmist, I will say this is perhaps the most painful period that Indian economy is going through. I mean, you look at any sector. Is there any sector that is not stressed today? Big factories are shut. Large enterprises will be hit. Yes, they may not be retrenching. But what are the, you know, what we are going to see is a huge erosion, both in jobs as well as wages. And I don't think we can afford that at this stage. The government will be soundly advised to steer every effort in the direction that jobs and wages can be preserved, because this is going to be an extremely, extremely tough time for the Indian economy, and there is no denying that.
Okay. Nasir Saleem, Managing Partner of Flexi Capital, is also with us. Nasir, good evening. How do you assess the situation? You know, because you have already started to hear from various industries cases of either salary cuts or job losses. I mean, the fact that so many daily wagers were going back on foot was because someone sacked them.
See, Sanket, I'll tell you, obviously, we need to be cautiously optimistic. I mean, I don't want to give you a very, situation where we're looking at a complete disaster as far as the economy is concerned. But the fact is that, yes, you see, some of these salary cuts will now start to show up its impact over the next 2 months, right? Obviously, the government has stepped in. You've seen a huge amount of action by the RBI clearly come in and, you know, giving certain benefits in terms of materials, deferred certain outstanding loans, therefore interest costs. So obviously, central banks have come into play. Even the government has looked at giving certain reliefs, which has happened in the form of certain grants. But I think here's the challenge I see and where we see. India is purely an investment and a consumption driven economy. I think the MSME is a very key sector that needs to be looked at more carefully by the government. I think that is something which I would be happier to see more action, more support being given to the MSME sector, because that's where they have the maximum number of employment generation. See, the urban poor is where we need to address some of our concerns immediately. I think if we can do that, we should be able to pretty much come out of this. I think the one good thing, Sanket, I must clarify to you is, of course, you know, as we say, common shocks require common policy. Whether it's the ECB or the Fed, everyone has announced, all central banks today have announced policies to ensure that there is a certain relief given in terms of injecting money in the economy, or in terms of pushing in more money supply. And I think that will help us and globally a lot of economies come out of the situation. Because I think what we need currently is, like the way back in 2008, we had a human crisis that we saw quantitative easing.
Okay.
Basically, was adopted by the Fed.
Okay, Nasir Saleem, there seems to be some problem with your audio. We're going to fix this because, you know, you're making a pertinent point. It's getting lost somewhere in the air. So we're going to fix this audio line and come back to you. Rajat Sethi is now also with us. Rajat. We were just speaking to the Industries and Commerce Minister of Andhra Pradesh, and he seemed to mention a very, very interesting point. He said that China's loss could possibly be India's gain, and that could be the silver lining post-corona, that people may want to look at India as a possible manufacturing hub as opposed to China. Do you think that's
Sanket,
a good possibility?
Actually, that is certainly, that's not even, there isn't any doubt about it, because if you see what USISPS, that think tank which assists the US corporations to come into India and help in their go-to-India strategy, they have already stated that there are around 200 firms, US firms, who want to shift their operations into India. And they are already looking into avenues and opportunities as to how to do that. Tax-wise also, our corporate tax are among the lowest in the world right now, and they would want to certainly capture this opportunity. And I think the government is acutely aware of this fact, and they are doing everything possible to offer a glide path for them to switch over from the Chinese-based exposures that they have and move to India. And not just that, there are other other European firms also who are already in touch with the Ministry of Commerce and are looking at diversifying the risks that they believe they were never exposed to, which China has apparently now.
But you know, Rajat,
presented before
the point that you seem to be making is recovery and expectations in the long run. See, the crisis is also going to be in the short term. And that is going to be the crisis of large-scale joblessness, the kind we've seen on the road from Anand Vihar, people setting on foot. Obviously, these are people who've been sacked. Many of them will be absorbed once this crisis gets over. But then this crisis is going to remain. Professor Arun Kumar is also with us. Supriya, I'll come to you. Professor Arun Kumar, how do you assess this situation? I mean, the true economic impact of COVID-19 in India.
So, you know, this started as a health emergency. And therefore, there was a lockdown. And by definition, a lockdown means people cannot go to work. So as was being said earlier, a large number of people could not go to work. And this did not happen when the national lockdown took place. It happened even earlier because many state governments were implementing lockdown and supplies had been already disrupted. So many industries were in trouble, for instance, the airlines industry, etc. And they were sacking their, you know, contract labor, etc. So as soon as, you know, the incomes decreased, people started migrating. But the point that should be understood is that, as was already said, that the unorganized sector, which is the dominant component of the Indian employment and a large part of the output, then that declines, overall demand declines, and when demand declines, industry further has problems. So this is a problem which is worse than a war. At least in a war, the demand does not go down. But here, the demand has gone down and the supply bottlenecks have been created and supply chains have been disrupted. So this situation is not something in which monetary and fiscal policies can really work. Those policies work only during, you know, the regular business cycle. Here, you know, the problem is when you have a lockdown, even if you cut interest rates, industries cannot operate, you know. So therefore, you know, investment is not going to be there. And as long as demand is short, investment is not going to come. Similarly, when there's a lockdown, even if you boost the economy, you know, consumption is not going to come up because people are going to only spend on the essentials. And large number of people have lost their incomes. They don't even have incomes to buy food. So how would they buy anything else? So this problem is much more severe than a war. It's a problem coming both from demand and supply. And therefore, what we can only do is to preserve life, you know, provide essentials to the large number of people. And if we had done that from the beginning, you know, that in all the slum clusters and the housing colonies, if we had provided essentials, people wouldn't have come out. Now, when people are coming out and not only going to the market, but also, you know, migrating in a mass scale to the villages, then the lockdown has no meaning because, you know, people are mixing. People are probably carrying the COVID-19 disease with them. So in a sense, you know, I think we needed better planning of the whole thing. It was definitely a health emergency. You know, lockdown was probably needed, but it needed to be planned better, needed to be planned earlier. So I think, you know, we are going to face trouble in the economy for quite some time because, you know, to restart production where working capital has been exhausted by small scale and the cottage sector, working capital probably will be lost by a large number of businesses and there may be many business failures. Financial sector also will suffer if businesses fail because, you know, the loans will not be repaid. So, you know, the financial sector could also go down. And given the interlinkages in the financial sector, you know, one firm's failure leads to another firm's failure and so on. And exports are unlikely to revive very soon, given the fact that large number of economies globally are suffering. So we can't even depend really on increasing exports. So all told, you know, consumption is down, investment is down, exports are down. And therefore, I think we have lost at least 70% to 80% of production capacity, not capacity, but production at this point of time compared to capacity. So the situation is quite grim.
Okay.
And therefore, the government has to act to preserve life at this point and wait and hope that the COVID-19 dissipates very quickly in India.
No, Professor Kumar, you seem to say, I understood your assessment. You said the government needs to act. The big question is how? I think the biggest challenge is going to be how and what needs to be done. Supriya Sinet.
The only thing it can do is preserve life at this point of time. But its stimulus is not going to stimulate the economy because the businesses are closed. People are not going to be spending more. So I think at this point, the fiscal stimulus can only preserve life. And I think that's what the concentration should be so that people stay at home, the COVID does not spread. And I think that's what should be attempted at this point
of time. Okay, Supriya, very quickly, Supriya.
Sanket, very quickly, what I would want to say at this stage is that the government has to realize its efforts have to be focused in the right direction. I agree with Professor Arun Kumar that the government can't kickstart business cycles right now. The government can't incentivize production because there can no production that can take place. You would be surprised to know that the four firms that have got the approval for test kits cannot manufacture because there are no assembly lines, there are no people, factories aren't functioning. So the government cannot, with its fiscal policies, move the needle on investments or consumption. And the RBI, with its monetary stimulus, can't move the needle on credit offtake. So what can happen? I agree with Professor Arun Kumar that life has to be preserved, and which is why the government has to take a two-pronged approach. The first is funds have to be directed to people who are to keep them safe, to keep them alive. And which is why I talk about the daily wage laborers, the construction workers, the marginalized, the poor, the farmers. These are the people who have been most impacted by the coronavirus and the lockdown that has followed. And the second most important thing that the government has to do is it has to decentralize decision making. It has to decentralize this fight against corona. The fight against corona, the battle, will have to be fought at the local level, at the level of district administration. So states have to be empowered. And already we are seeing states being extremely crunched for funds. You've got states, some states that we know of that have withheld public officials' salaries to be able to tide over the crisis. States have written to the Prime Minister for more funds. So I think states will have to be given more funds because they are going to be the front line.
But isn't the centre going to face the same problem? Where are the funds? There will be a funds problem at the center as well.
It's not as if the government of India doesn't have funds. It's not as if the government of India doesn't have funds. The RBI has opened a ways and means advances scheme. The 30% limit that has gone up should have been done without interest. And very quickly, before I hand it over back to you, I will make a quick point. This is not the time to think about getting work from China. You know, when the trade war was on, we could not get any work from them. Work actually went to Vietnam and Bangladesh. This is not the time. This is the time to look inwards, to do everything to preserve life and to preserve livelihood. Like I say, jobs and wages are important.
Jobs and wages, yes. Rajat Sethi, would you respond to that?
See, I understand that the 21-day initial lockdown has basically front-loaded the pain. This was a decision where there is a trade-off between health concerns and the economic concerns.
This was a crying necessity.
We have front-loaded. Yeah. See, you need to understand there are other policymakers like Donald Trump, the U.S. president, who is having a W-shaped response. First time he goes and says there will be lockdown, then he backtracks and says he has to open the economy, and then again goes back and enforces social distancing. So you need to understand even the global leaders are finding it difficult to balance this trade-off. It's not as easy as it seems to be. And here Prime Minister Modi is also facing this tough constraint as to how much do you lock down, and really pray that you don't have to extend the lockdown at all. And this is what the cabinet secretary also hinted at. And we all hope that the number of cases are well in control. It doesn't get onto that exponential curve. And if that is the scenario which unfolds, then things will certainly get back on track. And this is what the UNCTAD also, which you were just quoting on your television, that they have said there are only two economies which will bypass recession. Perhaps it will be China and India, among all the Western economies and all the developed economies.
All right. Nasir Saleem, Supriya Srinath, Professor Arun Kumar and Rajat Sethi, thank you so much to all of you. We are on day 8 of the lockdown. I don't know how long. So we still have a few more days left. As of now, the government says that there is no expression to extend or intent to extend this lockdown. But the impact, the assessment and our response economically to tide over this crisis will be very interesting to talk about. This is just a halfway or a midway assessment that we are carrying out. Thank you so much, all of you all. That brings us to the end of Left, Right and Center.